WTF WOTW
with Rudy Rue. Hey, 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 welcome to episode 18 of What the Fuck Went On This Week. I'm honored to be joined by an industry vet whose operatic range will lead you on a climactic journey while you two-step. With a sexy growl reminiscent of Eartha Kitt in Boomerang and the boldness of Strange, her voice will rain on your mister like blackberry molasses drizzled on a Dutch pancake on a fall morning. Ladies, gents, and all in between, feel free to throw your undergarments on our virtual stage for the Mac Diva who stands for family as she pens you and your mama's favorite song. The one and only Sandra St. Victor, y'all.
Oh, hey, girl. What's up, Rudy?
What's up?
I need you to do that intro every day for me. When I go to breakfast, I need that intro.
Well, I mean, you have the podcast now, so.
Theme. Ask Us will be playing everywhere I go.
So will this mean you will be more encouraged to promote the episode?
Absolutely.
No.
Absolutely. Absolutely. We in.
Good. Well, I'm glad. Well, I haven't seen you since like Jesus and the Last Supper.
Yes, I know. That's kind of nuts.
But I see you got a fresh fade and everything.
Yeah, I'm like, you know, making it, you know.
Camera easy. Ready. I like it.
It's working for me. Make my life simple. That's what I need right now.
Cool. Where's your beverage?
Oh, right here. We're working with a lovely Pico Guardo. This is a lovely sponsor line. Yeah, so I'm actually trying this out for the first time on the show. So I'm a bit of a wine snob. So if it sucks, we may have to stop this whole shit and have to go to another one. So we'll see.
I'm happy that I'm here to witness the, you know.
We'll have to see.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
Uh-oh.
Okay. Mm. All right, I'm going to let her breathe a little bit.
Oh, okay.
What you sipping on?
Tequila pineapple. Patron, to be exact.
Oh, there you go, my girl. All right.
Yeah, no, because are you ready for the sip?
No, I'm trying to let it breathe a little bit.
Well, I'll sip on our behalf so we could just get the show started then. Let's send a positive shout out to John Legend and Chrissy Teigen, who lost their baby.
Yes, that broke my heart today. It's like I feel like I know them.
Chrissy Teigen was so open about the journey. And on the flip side, I guess, you know, congratulations to Nicki Minaj for having hers.
Hey, there you go. All right.
So I want to shake things up a little, and I want to peel back some layers with some rapid-fire questions. Are you down?
Why not?
Okay.
I'm ready.
Stretch, yeah. All right. Call or text?
Oh, text, man.
Awful.
I'm sorry. I'm that bitch.
Climb a mountain or jump from a plane?
Definitely climb a mountain because nah.
As a student, were you messing with boys under the bleachers or buried in books in the library?
Both.
Oh, okay.
Oh, no, that. Boys and girls.
Oh. Oh, I thought you meant both the boys in the books, but you meant both genders.
What, all of that, I meant, so just go, yeah. Okay, next question.
So the layer is peeling early. Cool, it works. Why does your biggest addiction or guilty pleasure?
Probably wine, man. No, you know what? No, because wine, I don't really look at it as guilty, but probably television. I'm addicted to crime shows.
I feel you. I like them. Yeah. As well as the reality shows. Name a song written by someone else that sounds like something you could have written.
Oh, my God. Oh, damn. Damn, it's supposed to be rapid fire, right?
Okay. I mean, it could be like, you know, slow down fire.
Several times that I've heard something, I go, damn, why didn't I think of that? Oh, okay. So like the song by Men Condition, Pretty Brown Eyes.
Oh, of course.
That sounds like it could have been a Family Stand joint. You know, pop them horns, pop that. It sounds like some Pete Lord, Jefferson Smith, Sandra St. Vic. That sounds like us to me.
If you could travel back in time, which era would you go to?
the 18th dynasty in Egyptian times. Okay. In the time where like Hatshepsut became pharaoh.
Say that three times real fast.
Hatshepsut. When she decided to wear a beard, a full beard, and the regalia of a man, and become pharaoh. She said, well, you can't be pharaoh unless you mention a prop.
So she grew that shit out?
Well, they wouldn't let her do it otherwise. She had the power, she had the military might, she had the brain, she had the brawn, she had everything, but they just said, you have to be a man. She said, I will be a man. Anyway, I'm going to be pharaoh, so deal with that. So, I mean, in those times, but that's not why we traveled to that era.
Oh, okay.
That particular era was just a very strong time in the development of African history. Mm-hmm. When we were laying this foundation for literally most civilized societies to come after us.
Okay, that's a good reason. You're a married woman now.
Shona.
But tell me about a whirlwind entanglement you had as a young sex siren surrounded by men.
Ooh, damn, that's how long we got? How long is this show?
Yep, that one.
That gave me so much trouble, man.
It's okay. Nobody listens to the show.
Well, what do I have to tell you about the entanglement? Does it mention a name or does it have to be a big name?
And this one not. Later we'll get to names.
So no names?
Not this time, but a name will be required later on in this conversation. So
I have to be careful.
No, I think, you know, if you name a bunch, you're safer throughout the show, because then it's kind of like, no, everyone got it.
Yeah. I mean, you know, listen, to be honest, I'm no spring chicken. And I've always been a free spirited, you know, I was on the road, of course, you know, I was singing backgrounds. So I was on the road a lot. And when you're on the road, there's of course, a gazillion opportunities to do all kinds of things.
With like groupies or the band members?
Oh, well, no. So never with a groupie. I got to at least know where it's been. And so,
like the know. Dick has been? Or
I got to know what it is.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
I don't do rando, you know.
Yeah, okay.
And those little rough.
You need some travel history.
Show me your passport. You know. Right.
The visa stamps on the dick.
I need some stamps, you know, I need some blood tests. I even though I was a free spirit, I was always, I'm gonna say careful, but I think I was smart and strategic.
But this was also the 80s, right?
Yeah.
So that's also with the whole AIDS thing coming up.
Exactly. So I was not just willy-nilly out there, you know what I mean? I took precautions, but I enjoyed my 20s.
Okay. So that was a great way of stalling, but thank you for the background info. We'll come back to this. We're going to get a name. But let me ask you for another name, though. Name someone you looked forward to working with that disappointed you.
Oh, damn.
Listen, if anybody who's been around so many artists can tell us who how it really is... It's you.
Yeah. It disappointed me.
Not because they did something to you personally, but just asshole.
Well, okay.
Don't come with no diatribe, okay? Name.
Okay. So I'll just say, so Common. Okay. Then that's it. I'm done.
Common.
I'm out, though. I'm done with that.
Oh, okay. Well, he'll come up later, too. No, I'm just playing.
I'm sorry, Common, if you ever see this. I'm sorry.
Oh, he gonna see it because I'm gonna be tagging him. Describe the perfect kiss after you take that sip.
Oh, that's good shit.
Okay, don't come on air.
So we're talking like blackberry tannins and like a little hint of citrus. That's nice.
I thought you were describing the perfect kiss.
Oh.
Actually,
uh-huh. The perfect kiss is kind of like the first sip of a marvelous wine, because it's got that smoothness and that gushiness, but it's still got the edge and the power, the strength behind confidence.
It sounds like you know what you want. A project you were supposed to be involved in, but shit went another way.
Daughters of Soul.
What you mean? Weren't you in it?
Yeah, of course I was in. Daughters of Soul documentary is what I'm...
What happened to the documentary?
It went another way.
All right. Okay, moving on. Your biggest pet peeve.
Quite anal, so I have several. But I hate when, I hate people that don't keep their word.
Gotta have a little honor. So, especially during this whole COVID period, I think people have taken free license with
this. It's ridiculous.
Yeah. It's like, you know, yeah. On a scale of 1 to 10, what's your freak number?
10,000? That's not really the answer, but...
Oh, it's the answer. All right. Well, name someone you admire and still want to meet.
Oh, still want to meet. Ooh. Here's the thing. I know so much about people. So if I thought I wanted to meet them, I found out something about them and I really don't want to meet them no more. So it keeps...
Give me that example. Who's that? Name one of them. You don't want to meet them no way, so we ain't got nothing to lose.
Okay, Seal. Okay, I was like, but you know, I know who I don't know nothing about is Barbara Streisand. Let me write a song for Barbara Streisand.
Yeah, let's put that out there. Anybody who knows Barbara Streisand but has negative shit, don't even come this way. Well, I know someone you ain't trying to meet. The presidential debate. What the fuck was that?
Okay. First of all, I had a mini stroke that evening watching that because I was upstairs, stayed up all night. Donald Trump is not an idiot, okay? And as somebody who lived in New York as I did, we already knew what kind of strategic asshole, what kind of debauchery and treachery, what depths he would go to achieve his goals. He don't give a shit about anybody, okay? Anybody. I mean, he will throw his kids under the bus. Other than Ivanka, he will throw every last one.
Well, because that's because he wants to fuck her.
He wants to do her.
Yeah.
Okay, so we call her daughter wife. So he came on that stage with the intention to basically not let Joe Biden get a word in edgewise and to shake him up so much that he would trigger his stutter.
This is all about trying to dissuade people from voting because he's trying to scare people into thinking that it's not gonna be legitimate. Show up and vote. You will determine the outcome of this election. Vote, vote, vote. Do it, say it.
You wanna call him, what do you wanna call him? Give me a name,
White supremacists and white
supremacists. Who would you like me to condemn?
White supremacists and right
Proud Boys. Stand back and stand by.
I mean, he spoke about the man's son. Like,
his dead son, his life. He was just like, the guy, every day I wake up and I'm like, is the nightmare over? Because I feel like I'm in a dark matter sort of alternate universe and that this is not really happening and that America did not actually elect Donald fucking Trump to hold the levers of power and have the nuclear... Donald Trump, do y'all know Donald Trump? No, they don't. All they know is that reality show. Yep. Most of America only knew him from The Apprentice, which made him look like a successful, amazing, you know, strategic businessman. That guy was a...
I must say, I used to watch that show, and I enjoyed it, and I didn't even mind him on the show that much. Like, he was more coherent.
Of course,
when he was talking, you know what I mean?
They told him what they gave him. He had scripts and edits.
But he has scripts now that he's choosing to ignore.
He thinks his brain is bigger than everybody's in the room.
Right.
That's narcissism at full tilt is what that is.
Well, his niece, Mary Trump, who had recently also wrote a book about it, she said that his Proud Boys comment wasn't a shout out to white supremacists, but should be seen more as an order.
It was
to them.
It was. It was definitely, he was very clear. He actually repeated that today. He repeated it in front of the cameras. But they heard him loud and clear because they went on a tangent online. Their logo is now Stand By, you know, Proud Boys Stand By. That's their whole, so they're like celebrating because they have now the validation and marching our orders from the highest office in the land. You know, brothers and sisters now are not, we're arming up. God bless Martin Luther King, you know, him and John Lewis's sacrifice, it meant everything, it still means everything. But This is not the game right now. We are on a trip that America is not ready for.
Well, thanks to a new law signed by California Governor Gavin Newsom, the state is the first to consider reparations for slavery. Yeah. Have you heard about that?
Yeah, I did.
Rapper and semi-bootleg activist T.I. claims that every Black person should get $1 million.
Hey, listen, bro. Fuck that shit they got their offer. You can't do me wrong and then tell me how you gonna fix it. You fuck up with me, I got to tell you what it takes to fix it. And we want 10%. I know 10% sound low, but there's a method to my madness. All we got to do is stick together. I'm trying to get every motherfucking Black person in America $1 million.
Do you agree?
No.
Because the reparations thing also is, when is the beginning and the end of it? Like, exactly. Shouldn't it be like descendants of people who have directly been?
Yes. So what you have is, oddly enough, ADOS, which is African Descendants of Slaves, which is a movement in America. They sort of align a lot with Trump theories, and it's a really odd, you know, political bed marriage. Call them the Hoteps too, and about specifying who is eligible specifically for that thing. So you got so many issues with defining that. Obviously, I'm a Black person. I grew up in America in the South. I'm adopted. You can't trace my parent back past my mom. You know what I mean? Because I don't know nothing about her. Then you have people that migrated who are descendants of slaves in Haiti, Jamaica, the West Indies. You know, there's a lot of things that make that like almost impossible to navigate. But I'm not saying it's impossible to do reparations. I think they need to figure out, there has to be a way. What was promised to us was land. Mm-hmm. And so you think about the promise of the 40 acres and a mule, the several of African descent communities during Reconstruction that were burned to the ground. Put that in one pile and you put in the other pile what America did for like the GI Bill from the veterans that came back, well, the not Black people, but the other, and all the help they got to develop wealth. So let's talk about giving people land. Let's talk about giving people assets. Let's talk, because you start putting a dollar amount on it. Mm-hmm. First of all, it cheapens it and it makes it seem like we just want to get our, you know, we're
like a check, yeah.
But what we do want is some sort of acknowledgement that we have been put on. The scale has never been balanced. What's been taken from us is generational wealth. Let's try to fix that shit.
So I don't know if you're still about that rubber life, but a Vietnamese condom factory is accused of recycling used prophylactics.
Girl, I saw that. That just made me... Sorry.
The factory owner allegedly admitted buying used condoms, washing them, and packing them into new packages. The police found 320,000 repackaged condoms in the raid. Uh-oh. It's probably safer to raw dog it in Hanoi right now. I can't imagine they imported the used condoms, so I'm assuming they're keeping it local.
They said they were, you know, sold in Vietnam.
I'm good. A Whitney Houston hologram has emerged without her estate's permission.
They had one out there that was approved by the family.
Right. So Pat Houston had signed a deal with Primary Wave Publishing for a posthumous concert tour with the hologram. It was to be in Holland earlier this year.
Yes.
But, you know, obviously it was on hold, but producer Scott Storch jumped the gun and signed a deal with Hologram USA for a variety show concept he had featuring past icons.
No.
That he sold to a TV network, and she's obviously one of the icons. But how do you feel about this whole hologram concept?
I do not like it. First of all, it's creepy. Whitney Houston is gone, okay? We have her. What we have are memories and videos, recordings. We have that. What are they going to start doing? Cloning them next? Fuck that. That's where these people are going, these creepy bastards.
There's a big leap between the hologram and the clone.
These people are creepy. Okay? They want dead people on stage.
But wouldn't you want to, like, if you could, like, see Ella Fitzgerald like get the feel of what it would be like to have been in that room. Wouldn't it be nice?
I've seen her live. But no, here's
okay, you old, I forgot.
I would have loved to have seen Jimi Hendrix live, man.
See?
I would love, but I don't want no hologram of him.
That's but at least you could have gotten that feel, you know, you get to see
the I would not get that feel.
No,
I would not
the whole time you'd be thinking like, damn, this, I would, like, this is
some, this is some creepy ass, and we all weird for even being here. I would be like,
but you would still go.
No, I wouldn't. I would, if, you would have to take me there on a surprise concert and then, oh, you're gonna love this. I would not purchase a ticket or get a, or accept a guest pass for no damn hologram show.
Let me return this ticket I had. Serena Williams just pulled out of the French Open due to injury. Do you think her tennis career is tapering off, or can she win another Grand Slam?
Somebody like Serena Williams is like, just when you think it's about that time for them to wrap it up, they get another ring, another trophy, you know what I mean? I think she's still got one more in her, to be honest. With somebody at her age and with her physical strength, and she just had a baby, right? But she still got it in her spirit-wise. She could work herself back up to probably grab one more.
Let's shift gears a little. Do you like Mary's music?
Mary who?
Jay Blige.
oh. I like Mary J. Blige a lot.
Well, I know someone who does not and is not shy about blasting her daily this week.
Oh, shit, who?
I'm talking about the super talented neo-soul songstress from Philly with a derailed career, Jaguar Wright.
Mary J. Blige has turned her back on almost everybody that's ever cared about her, ever loved her. Her and her sister, Latanya, Latoya, whatever the fucking bitch name. They're awful people. Y'all just don't know it because you believe what their publicist tells you. Because you'd rather believe their lies than believe the actual truth. She's a whole gay woman. She's been gay ever since her and KC ended it. And everybody knows it. So why is she still in the closet?
Well, she's been going on a few of them the past, I think, for a month and a half.
I've seen the other ones.
Which kicked off with your boy Common allegedly putting his dick in her mouth while she was sleeping back when they were messing around. So anyway, her IG rant started off with her saying that Mary has been disrespecting and undermining talented upcoming female singers for her entire career.
Because you won't tell the truth, you're being held hostage by a lie for someone that you know does not have your best interest at heart. And what does that what happens after that? You become bitter. And Mary took it out on every female artist that was better than her, you know? And Mary J. Blige has been a cheerleader for Beyonce her whole career. But she hates every other chick in the game because somebody paid her to. Mary J. Blige should hate Beyonce more than anyone because Beyonce is everything that Mary J. Blige will never be. So why is she always sucking on Beyonce titty, but she treat every other female like shit because somebody is paying her?
What did Mary do?
I was going to ask you if you had heard this about Mary.
I had not heard that about Mary. I know people that work with her. I mean, you know, I did one backup thing with her back in the day, way back in the day. And I just never heard anything, you know, because people talk, you know.
I was listening. She went on for a whole hour.
Because that bitch got to work. She is a monkey on a stage. And then they crank it up. And the organ grinder get to going. And Mary gets to going. She got to. What else is she capable of doing? What else is she qualified to do? She ain't get a GED till she was 36 years old. What problem do I have with Mary J. Blige? She's a betrayer to women. She's on the down low. She's petty as fuck. And Puff is still running her. And they say, come on, Mary, we got an award show for you. And we got a TV show for you. And you're going to be a star on Netflix. And guess what? She ain't even collecting all that bread.
Okay.
People automatically put her in the crazy category, right?
Yeah, I understand that, but I think that's unfair too.
And I think, you know, for regular folk, sometimes it's hard to fathom. They see something as like burning the bridge because to them, the end goal is the traditional path of how the artists go. They don't understand that there are people who've been in the game for so long that could reach the no fucks given phase of things. Yeah, you. because I wanted her on my show, but not to talk about this stuff.
For sure.
Well, she acknowledged receiving the message, but it's still like stutter stepping on the actual reply. On her voice is so effortless still. If all that smoking and shit she does, she can still sing.
Yeah, no doubt. Can't blame it on love. Common sense, it plays its part. I can't blame it on you, no.
See you addressing it this way, but you could have.
Oh, definitely.
Yeah, maybe you'll write a book.
I just, you know, the bottom line is, I don't want to be that bitch.
But you know what book I really want to get my hands on is the Mariah Carey memoir.
Like, ooh, is she writing?
Yeah.
Is she gonna be real? Is a question.
Yeah, like, I mean, she revealed that her big sister abused her and tried to pimp her out for drugs when they were younger. Because all you.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, and then she gives a peek into her marriages to Tommy Mottola and Nick Cannon, but also her sexcapades, including a one-night stand that was supposed to take place with Eminem but fizzled out because he prematurely ejaculated in his pants.
Oh my God, that's hilarious.
Any titillating tales from your sex, drugs, and rock and roll days you want to preview today? You were warned. You see how we circled that? You see how it is?
Yeah, I saw. We're talking about somebody else. That was good. That's nice. Well done.
I mean, episode 18. I'm low-key professional now.
So, Jaguar, while don't blow my shit up, let me just tell all my shit here.
Yes, because she did say she's going to tune in. No, I'm just
playing. I'll tell you the Rick James story. So, here's the thing. We have been, you know, I'm really tight with my girl Shaka, of course, you know, mm-hmm. And
that's Shaka Khan for those listening.
So you know, we used to get high a little bit.
What was the drug of choice back then?
Cocaine. Oh, okay. Freebasing, baby. We was freebasers.
Okay.
But we don't get high no more.
Because I was gonna say, if you want to take a freebase break.
No, I'm fine. I'm good.
Thanks. Okay. All right. You know, because I want my guests to be comfortable. Track break. I mean, there's no judgment. It's a safe place.
No judgment. Okay. Thank you. We hang out with Rick one day, and he asked us to come up to the house. And at that time, I was living with Shaq and I were living together on the Upper West Side. So
why were y'all living together as grown women?
We're friends. So we took the
limo. Were you special friends?
We were friends. So okay. We took the limo up to Rick's house. I walk in his house. It's a mansion, you know? And I've been in rich people's houses, but this is like, just, you know, over the top. He's gaudy, you know? So, yeah. And there's hoes all over the place. It's like, it looks like a fucking
bunch of super freaks, yeah.
It's like, am I in a video? And he just walked by all of them and, you know, and took us into his bedroom. Massive. I've never seen a bed that big.
You come to visit him. To say what's up?
We just like to get high. And we like to get high on other people's supply. So we knew that Rick James would have a crazy supply. Mm-hmm. So we just gonna go up there and let's juice this dude for his supply. And then he took Yvette and I into the bathroom.
Okay.
It's massive. Okay, it's massive. I see it like right now in front of me. Mm-hmm. And so this is a mirror as long as a wall. And on the countertop.
It was also a dance studio.
Pretty much. Just piles of blow. And so he's cooking shit and he's just cooking. And so as opposed to like, I don't know if you know how to freebase. So if it's
I'm not a freebase specialist. So no, take me through the steps. It's fine.
Okay, so you fill the bowl up, you know, and then you inhale it, right? Mm-hmm. So he fills a bowl up.
What's smart? Right?
Well, he inhales it. And instead of holding it, he turns to me.
Oh,
you know, he wants to.
Okay. Oh, with weed.
So with weed, right? The same thing, but this is super crack. So he gives it, and I see Yvette like get madder and madder. It's funny as fuck. But I knew
it's because Shaka's getting upset, and you're getting. You think it's funny? Why was she getting mad?
That was funny to me. So because obviously he was trying to like, you know, come on to me. She didn't like that. On one of these little turns of him trying to blow smoke in my mouth, you know, and she's like, listen. She's my bitch. And he looks at her like, well, she in my house. she my bitch. So they started like going
you
at
just
it.
Both their bitches in the middle, huh?
I was like, so they were like really like screaming at each other because everybody's high now, okay? So they were screaming. I just took the pipe, went out to, you know, was to chat with a couple of hoes.
Were you chill with the hoes in the house while they were fighting over you? No, that is funny. Shaka won, right?
Oh, yeah, of course. I'm leaving with her. You know, it's my girl. It's my baby. You know, we was leaving together. But we definitely got what we came for.
So, in this edition of How Low Can a Motherfucker Go, Michael Jackson's cousin is allegedly auctioning off his final IV drip.
What you talking about, Willis?
Creeper.
So the IV setup includes the tubing and bag used to administer the propofol that killed him. So Marcia Stewart said she found it in his home on the nightstand and wants a minimum of $2,500 for it.
Martha Stewart?
No. Marcia Stewart.
Oh.
Yeah, I think this is a good time to tell you that Martha Stewart is indeed Michael's cousin. He is white. No.
My God, come on.
And you know, I had to do research because I was like, what motherfucking cousin is doing this? And of course, it's like one of them side Joe Jackson babies. One of them like side heifers floating around. I don't know how she got in there. I didn't read that deep. I mean, they kind of lost me at, I saw a bag with a white substance and I know that's what propofol looks like.
I didn't even know what propofol was till after Mike died.
Clinical drugs is not my ministry, but... Maybe it's yours. You did more chemical research.
I definitely did, and I never heard of propofol until after the dude died.
Well, you ain't got high till you had that propofol, girl. We're going to hell. A German soccer team lost a game 37-0 after social distancing from the opponents. The losing team actually
you almost made me spit my water.
The losing team actually didn't even want to play and risk getting exposed to the virus, but were threatened with being fined. So they put the minimum amount of players that they could put, which is 7, and just gave them space. You've worked with numerous artists spanning about 4 decades. Can you share one of your fondest behind the scenes memories with any of them?
So we were Fam Stan, producer Paul Abdul,
mm-hmm.
and we were in the studio to do, the song was called Will You Marry Me, and it's on a Spellbound album. And there was a section that we wanted to have Stevie Wonder come in and do a harmonica solo. And he was like, yeah, okay, so he came through. And I knew Stevie from every time I've seen, Stevie remembers me from when I was a kid, right? Because when I was a kid back in Dallas, I met him backstage, and he talked to us for hours. He sat on the couch, and I was literally like just sitting, leaning on his knee on the floor while he just pontificated for hours. And I had a little cassette player, and I played him my song, and he told me about my voice and how he loved it. Anyway, so he, every time I saw him over the years, after I became successful or whatever, after. He always, do you remember? He said, of course I remember. He always asked me to remember. It's like he always remembered that. But anyway, that's not the story. The story is Paul Abdul session, Will You Marry Me? And he's in the booth. And so he started, you usually do a few takes of things. So he done a few takes. I'm behind the glass with Peter and Jeff from Fam Stan. I'm like, I have a suggestion, but I really don't want to say anything to Steve. I don't want to suggest shit to Stevie Wonder. And Jim's like, just go ahead. Just I'm like, that's Stevie Wonder. He's like, you just don't go, just go ahead. You need to push the button. I'm like, so you push the talk back button.
Right.
And then there I am. Mr. Wonder.
Hey. So
Hey, Sandra, you remember? Yeah, okay. Yeah. So listen, what I think is if you would just start off the solo with like the melody of the chorus just for like a bar and a half or so, and then go into the ad lib, then he said, oh yeah, scratch out, okay, I'll try that. And then he did it, and I'm like, I just told Stevie Wonder something to it.
Gave him some notes.
Record. Fuck! I was like, shit!
And he was receptive. He didn't bat an eye, right? He just said, oh, okay, yeah.
That's a good idea. He just did it. And I was like, what?
So?
That blows my mind.
you received a full college scholarship to study opera. Which tools from that genre do you feel help form your signature sound now?
Ooh, I think I would have to say that, like, the tone, right? Mm-hmm. Tone wise, so from opera, what you're taught how to placement of the voice, where to place the tone, and to get the body that you want, and to make it resonate, you know what I mean? So that placing in the front of my face, and you know, now in rock and in art and soul, that edginess on my tone is because of knowing that placement, where to put it, and how to make it cut through, and that sort of thing. So those, and also I think from opera, well, we just called it musicality, you know, as opposed to just singing. Mary had a little lamb. That's a vibe too.
Especially after an evening of freebasing.
Yeah, freebasing sounds just like, right. Yeah. Oh, he's a sick. I asked him. Anyway, so if I want to emote this, and then I go, then I can go from pianissimo to forte, and then back to pianissimo. I go, Mary had a little lamb. Mary had a little lamb. You know, so you
gotcha.
You get to, you know, you peaks, valleys, and you know, and then you learn about the vocal fry, and then you know, it's all
that is definitely your sound. Now that I hear it, yeah, you do that.
Yeah,
that's your thing. Well, Ghetto Heaven is one of your highest charting songs. Which other song from your entire catalog do you feel you could or should have achieved similar success with?
Come Over, which is on the Mac Diva Saves the World album. And so when I, anybody that knows my name, because people from that know the song Ghetto, that song is an international hit. Mm-hmm. People don't know that. They don't associate that with Sandra St. Victor. That's a problem. That's a big problem. Some know it's the Family Stand. Some just know the song. Okay, but they
don't even know the artist. It's like Happy Birthday. Nobody knows who made it up. Shit.
Yeah. That hurts still. But you know, it's been sampled a few times. Most notably by Common. You know,
right.
And D'Angelo and Macy Gray. Layla Hathaway sang a version of it with Hiram Bullock. But Come Over was on the soundtrack of the TV show Living Single. I'm lying, it wasn't on that song. No, it was another song on that.
All right.
Come Over was on the soundtrack of the movie, of the Martin Lawrence, Lynn Whitfield movie.
Oh, Thin Line Between Love and Hate.
I don't wanna tease you, baby. Don't wanna mistreat you now. I just wanna free you, daddy.
At least it was on something. Because if you'd have been like, oh no, it wasn't on shit.
It wasn't on shit. I just made that up. No.
Okay. Is there a career decision you made that you'd do differently if you had a redo?
Probably.
But you just don't. There's just so many. You want to just stop at that? Just probably.
Yeah.
That's fine. So, name a song made famous by another artist that most people don't know you worked on either as a songwriter or a producer.
Probably Soul Sanctuary, or maybe that's the Prince song, because a lot of people don't know that. Just say, what?
Soul Sanctuary by Prince. What did you do on that record?
I wrote it.
Okay. That's a pretty big song. So earlier you mentioned you were recording some new music this week. Is there anything you can preview?
I'll tell you what you can play.
Okay. What can I play?
Family Stand. The song that I'm talking about now is called Song for Michelle. The day after the debate, I did a rant with the video in the background, basically asking people to send me videos to join, to be in that video. I want people to, because the chorus of the song is based on Michelle Obama's phrase, when they go,
we go low, we go high.
And in our song, we're saying, if we go high and they go low, we're gonna fuck the motherfuckers up.
Oh, when we go high, if they go low, we gonna fuck the motherfuckers up. Send an image, oh, what a bitch. devil real? Yeah, he's a boss, but at a loss on how to remix the reality of
the maid Julie looks like a three stooge. No, not the curly, the Joe, he's the mo. Liar, habitual liars. I mean alternative truth. Well, you know.
You. Okay, so send those videos in because I'm gonna add different people singing that chorus to the video.
Okay, well, so I'm gonna need all of you soul music lovers and conscious folk listening to follow Sandra on all her social media, which is basically Sandra St. Victor across all platforms, and just add a .com for her website, which you can find her email address on too, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, this was fun.
I knew it was gonna be fun because you and I have never had no not entertainment hangs. We've always been able to.
Yeah, we don't need to talk about all our hangs. So.
No, we should not speak of all of those publicly, should we, love? Yeah.
Not all the hangs. So, any last words for the peasants out there? Just
the peasants.
The peasants.
Hey, listen, I mean, you know, if you're in America, I just need you to vote because fuck that. We can't.
Even if you're just in America. You should be casting that shit.
Wherever you at.
Yeah.
If you are an American citizen and able to vote, you need to vote. There's nobody asking to marry Joe Biden or Kamala Harris. We're just saying that we have to shift the power balance back to at least a reasonable degree of sanity so that we can make moves in the right direction. Is not a game. This is not a test. It's going to be over. So you have to vote in numbers that cannot be denied because he's also going to cheat.
So vote, motherfuckers. By the way, do you like Christmas?
Actually, I kind of love Christmas. I don't like the commerciality of it, but I love Christmas because I like playing the Jackson 5 Christmas album.
Cool. Do you ever wonder why Santa's sack is so big?
His nutsack?
Yeah. Probably because he only comes once a year. All right, y'all. Peace. Thank you for listening. We out this bitch.
Thank you for listening. You ain't got to go home, but you got to get the heck up out of here. Please be a friend. Tell a friend. Subscribe. Do something with your laugh. Catch you next week on
WTFWOTW
with Rudy Rue.